This procedure demonstrates the internal components of a 5800 series valve. Here we have the new Pentair 5800 valve. This valve has a lot of flexibility as well as some really nice new features. We're going to do a teardown on the valve so that you can see those features. The first thing to do is remove the top. We press in from both sides in order to remove it. After that, we move to the rear of the unit to continue our disassembly. The first thing we'll remove is the screw that holds the piston to the drive assembly. We can then remove the cable from the meter. Your meter cable may look different depending on which meter is used. After that, we can remove these two drive assembly screws. Once these two screws are removed, the drive is free. We'll pull forward and tilt a little bit to the front, and it will come loose. That gives us access to the three screws that keep the top plate, which holds the piston and the brine valve in. Using the same quarter-inch driver or slotted screwdriver, we will remove these three screws. Once those are loose, we'll pull up on the piston shaft and the top cap in order to release them from the unit. One of the features of the 5800 is that it has a one-piece construction for the seal and spacer stack, instead of our traditional individual seals and spacers. Trust that the material that we use here is the same as we use in our standard seals, so we can stand behind it. The next feature is our brine valve. This is our standard brine valve from our ProFlow series and is easy to test and check for the O-ring that is on here. Make sure that the plunger moves freely and there is no debris in it. Make note that there is an O-ring internal to the body that we need to seal against. We can then move to our drain assembly. This drain assembly is held in by a clip and is the same assembly that we use on our 2510 as well as our ProFlow valves. This particular unit has the embossing to say that it is listed for 1.5 gallons. After removing the drain, we can then move over to our injection system. The brine line flow control is held in behind this brass nut. This is our standard 1600 system brine line flow control. We have these available in 1/8, 1/4, 1/2, and 1 gallon flows. The sticker on the back of the body will indicate which one your unit originally came with. Make sure to match this. If necessary to be cleaned, you can pull the white clip loose and access the flow washer. The next thing we will do is remove the two screws to gain access to the screen and injector assembly. The sticker on the cap indicates which flow control and which injector were originally placed in the unit. We can then remove our screen assembly. This screen assembly is carryover from our ProFlow unit. That gives us access to our injector. You can use a set of needle nose pliers to hold on to the outside, or on this piece, the white edges. We do not want to grab by the black center piece. A better tool option is to use one of the red clips from our 7000 valve. Pulling straight forward, the injector is removed. These injectors snap together, so you can unsnap it in order to gain access to clean the ports on the ends of the unit. When you reassemble, make sure that they do not twist so that you have the spacing correct between the top and bottom half. The body, other than the O-ring and the brine valve, is now clear. Accessories such as meters and bypasses may still be assembled. We can then move on to the power head assembly. The design of the power head is one of flexibility. We will start with the cover on the unit. It uses a flexible plastic top coat and an insert bezel. The insert bezel can be optioned in blue, silver, or black. It can also be removed in order to change it. The next item is our controllers. The 5800 also has a flexible control system. There is the new for the 5800 LXT available. The other available controller is our SXT, which is the established Fleck residential controller. Other controllers may also be retrofitted to this unit in the future. To remove the controller, you begin by pressing in the two top tabs, pushing down and forward. Once you have the plate forward, that allows you access to the three connection points. The top connection is for your optical encoder and motor. The second connection is for your meter, if your system is a metered unit. The bottom connection is for your DC input to the controller. You can then pull upwards and remove the controller. If your needs should require you to change, all of the connections on the rear are in the same locations. To reset the controller, there is a reset button on both units. This, if you press and hold with power removed, will allow you to clear the memory on the unit. From here forward, the disassembly process of the power head is the same regardless of which control system is used. The first thing we will do is remove the optical encoder, which is located in the top center of the drive. We press forward and up in order to remove it. The next item we can remove, if your system is installed with it, is the meter cable. There are two loops in the front of the unit that the cable is tucked into. Pulling up and away will allow you to free them. Once it is free of the loops, we can move to the side. Pulling upwards on the front plate and downwards on the rear will allow the cable to be removed. Pulling through the back, the connector is now free. We can then move to remove the front plate from the back plate of the drive assembly. There are four tabs, two top, two bottom. We'll press those inward while pulling up on the front plate. This will remove the top plate, which has the power connector. This will give us access to our motor assembly and drive cams. The top plate is our optical encoder. The openings in the plate need to be free of debris, as it is counting from one step to the other based on these openings. Pull that straight forward. Make note that on the bottom of this gear, it is a Y shape so that it can only be assembled onto the drive cam one way. We then have access to the drive cam. Make note that there is a hole through the drive cam which will align between the drive cam, the brine cam, and the back plate. This will ease assembly to make sure that there is no damage to the gears. This gives us access to our brine cam, which also has a hole to line up with the back plate. The hole also matches up with where there is a tooth missing on the cog. This lines up with our drive assembly. We now have access to the motor and four sprockets. To gain access and remove them, we move to the rear of the unit. There are two pins at the top and one pin on the bottom. By pressing in on these three pins, we'll remove the plate that the motor is held to. There are four sprockets which do gear reduction for the DC motor. All four of these gears are identical, so that if you should have damage to one, you only have to order one, and there is no issue if you get them out of order when you're disassembling it. We can then move on to the DC motor. We're using a DC motor because it is more energy efficient and allows us to move between cycles quickly. It also allows us to replace it very easily. We pull outward on the two tabs while pressing upwards from the bottom. This allows the unit to easily be removed. The unit comes as an assembly for the optical encoder, the DC motor, and the connection. We have now completed disassembly of the 5800 valve. Reassembly is the reverse of this procedure. Good luck, and thanks for watching.